Hello and welcome. This video will demonstrate rotating, cropping, and resizing images, using and manipulating layers of elements, touch-up techniques, replacing colors, and adjusting levels. First, let's look at some of the basic tools for image editing. Here, we have a picture of the Mona Lisa, but it's tilted and not framed or sized correctly. To rotate an image, we use the Rotate tool. Simply click and drag to preview the rotated image. Once satisfied with the result, click Rotate. But as a result of the rotation, the image is no longer rectangular. This checkered pattern indicates areas of the picture that are now transparent. There is also a lot of unnecessary space around the Mona Lisa. The Crop tool will help with both problems. Let's first draw what's called a bounding box. This box gives a preview of the cropped image. As we click and drag the edges to adjust the box, spacers appear to help us outline an even boundary around our focal point. Press Enter to confirm the crop. Look at the zoom factor at the bottom of the window. This picture is a bit too big for a document or email. Let's resize it. A height of 600 pixels seems good, but you can resize it however you wish. The width is automatically adjusted to ensure the image is not distorted. This picture is of another Renaissance painting from the Louvre, but it's skewed. Let's fix that using the Perspective tool. With the tool selected, click on the image. A grid will appear to help guide us. Click and drag the corners of the picture until the edges of the frame align with the lines of the grid. If necessary, we could also crop or resize the image, but this is fine. So far, we've been looking at images as a flat, continuous region. But editing tools allow us to arrange picture elements in layers. Layers can be stacked, moved, and edited separately from the rest of the image. Let's take the man from this image and insert him into this group in the other picture. First, we need to isolate him from the rest of the picture. Let's use the Magic Wand tool. This tool selects contiguous regions of the image that have similar color. Thankfully, the background is relatively uniform in color. We can adjust the threshold value to adjust the sensitivity to color variations. We've now selected the background. But we want everything but the background. To accomplish this, we click on the Select menu and choose Invert. Next, we copy and paste the selection into our group. We need to add a new layer to hold the image of the man. Some image editing programs do this automatically. On the right, we see a listing of the layers of our picture. Right now, the layer has a transparent background, so we don't see it. We can paste the man and click on the layer to link the pasted pixels to this layer. The newly pasted element exists as its own layer and can be manipulated independently. There are some issues with this picture. First, he isn't the appropriate height relative to the others in the picture. We can transform him using the Resize tool. If we wanted to, we could also flip him to face the other way. The second issue is that he appears in front of everyone and everything else in the group picture. Let's put him in front of the door, but behind the sofa. Select the layer with the group picture. Next, select the area in the group picture that we want to appear in front of the man. We can do this using the rectangle marquee. Again, copy and paste. Note that only the pixels from the selected layer were duplicated. Ensure that the new layer appears on top of the layer with the man, and that the layer with the man is on top of the group picture. Now, we need to erase some pixels from the new foreground layer. I recommend first using a solid eraser to eliminate unwanted portions. Then, use a soft feathered eraser along the edges of the elements to blend the layers. Don't worry if you accidentally erase something, just undo it by pressing Ctrl or Command Z. People in the foreground are in focus, but not those in back. Let's try to blur the man so that he resembles the others in the background. We can save our changes. This will allow us to easily make changes in the future, but that will create a file that can only be opened by this software. To create an image that others can view, we make a duplicate copy, and then flatten the image to a single layer. We can then save it to the desired format. Here's another image, this time with a woman. Using the same techniques, I inserted her into the group as well. Here, we have a picture of a moth on a window. Unfortunately, there are some specks of dust and other anomalies that we want to eliminate. GIMP has two tools that can help us. The clone tool duplicates a source area to the target area. The heal tool does the same, but blends the source with the target for a more seamless result. We'll be using the heal tool here, but both tools work the same way. First, we hold the Ctrl or Command key and click on an area to select it as the source area. Without holding any keyboard keys, we can click on a trouble spot to hide it. If the flaw is still visible, click on it again. Every click will duplicate the source area and blend it with the target area. If there is a scratch or other flaw that extends, click and drag over the flaw. The source area will move in relation to the pointer. Suppose we wanted to replace one color with another. Let's change the color of this red bow tie. First, we use the magic wand tool to select surrounding pixels that are close in color. How close? We can adjust the threshold for close enough. The higher the threshold, the more colors it will select. We only want the red in the bow tie, so let's use a threshold around 38. In other situations, you will have to experiment for a good value. The first selection did not select all of the tie. That's okay. We can shift-click to add additional regions to the selection. If we want to use the selection again later, we might want to save it. Once saved, it can be loaded or added to an existing selection. Under the Color menu, select Hue Saturation. Drag the Hue slider to change the color of the selected pixels. Only the selected pixels change. Here, we have a picture that isn't lit very well. I didn't use a flash, but I don't think it would have helped in this case. We could adjust the brightness and contrast, but that tends to make the picture look washed out. Instead, we're going to adjust the levels of the image. This allows us to manipulate the bright, dim, and mid-range values independently. This histogram shows us the tonal level or brightness in our image. For each value, 0 to 255, the histogram illustrates approximately how many pixels are of that brightness level. By repositioning these triangles, we can map the actual distribution to a more ideal distribution. This white triangle will represent what value will be mapped to 255, white. As a personal general rule, I like to first move this triangle to the first rise or peak from the right. The dark triangle will represent what value will be mapped to 0, black. Again, this is my personal general rule, but I like to move it to the first rise or peak from the left. This picture is already starting to look better. The middle triangle represents how the midtones are mapped. Why is this a real number instead of an integer like the others? This number actually represents the gamma curve of the image. But don't worry, we won't be going into the mathematical details. By dragging the triangle to the left, the midtones are shifted towards white. Dragging to the right shifts midtones towards black. I tend to position it at or close to the highest peak in the histogram. From here, we can tweak the position of the triangles, but I think they're good where they are. As we've been adjusting the levels, we've been able to see the changes applied. That's because the Preview option is enabled. To compare the before and after, you can toggle this checkbox. This looks good, so I'll accept these settings by clicking OK. I hope these tips and techniques help you with your photos and images.